Good morning, students. I welcome you all for the class. In this class, we are going to discuss regarding monitors and also the message passing concept. Fine. So in the last class, we have gone through different classical problems of synchronization, right? So why we are going to study all the things in the sense, in order to provide cooperation between different processes, in order to synchronize different processes, like we are making use of all the classical tools, like producer-consumer problem we have seen, readers-writers problem we have seen, dining philosophers problem we have seen. So all the things what we are going to do, we are providing synchronization among the processes. Like why we need to provide synchronization in the sense, in order to avoid the race condition. So in order to avoid the race condition, we are going to provide synchronization among the processes. So as I have already said you that, what do you mean by race condition? Fine. So what do you mean by race condition? Suppose if we are going to have any shared variables like A, B, C are the shared variables, right? So A, B, C are the shared variables, like all these are shared variables. And these shared variables are going to be used by the two processes, process P1 and process P2. So shared variables in the sense, those variables are going to be shared among two processes. Those variables we are going to call them as shared variables. So these three shared variables are going to be shared among the process P1 and process P2. Suppose, so now what I am telling you is, I am telling you regarding the race condition. So this race condition should not be there in the cooperative processes. So what do you mean by a race condition in the sense, when the shared variables are shared among two processes? Suppose P1 wants B and P1 wants the C variable. So P1 is going to have a lock on, P1 is going to use a B variable and the C variable. At the same time, when P2 wants to utilize the, or P2 was in need of C variable, what it is going to happen? So here P1 is already utilizing the B variable and C variable, and it is going to do the task. Again, in the middle, this process P2 came and it is also telling that I want the variable C. So what it is going to have is, here we'll be going to have inconsistency of data. Inconsistency in the sense, the data will not be correct. Why? Because here the P1 variable is changing the C variable and P2 process is also changing the C variable. So the data is going to be not stable, inconsistent. So this inconsistency, we call it as a race condition. Inconsistent of data, we call it as a race condition. Or sometimes we can say that if P1 is used first, we'll be going to get the value of X, and if P2 is using, we'll be going to get the value of Y. But whatever the process used, the value should be stable. It shouldn't differ between the processes. But what it is happening over here, like here, as the C variable is going to be shared between the P1 process and the P2 process at the same time. What the thing you have to remember is, at the same time, if P1 and P2 processes are utilizing the same variable C, like we'll be going to have a race condition. But that race condition is not at all entertained. So in order to overcome that race condition, like what we are going to do is, we are going to provide synchronization. So how we are going to provide synchronization in the sense, we have make use of semaphores. Like till now we have been used semaphores, and another synchronization tool what we are going to discuss now is the monitors. So monitors is also the one which is going to provide synchronization between the cooperative processes. Till now we have seen regarding the semaphore. So what do you mean by a semaphore in the sense? It is a synchronization tool in which it is a variable actually. So semaphore S is a variable which provides synchronization among the processes by making use of two signals, wait and signal. So wait means we'll be going to have the value decremented by one, signal means we'll be going to have the value incremented by 1. So by making use of these two variables, the semaphores, we are going to provide synchronization, like we have seen all the things. So whatever the problems we have seen, that is dining philosophers, were producer, consumer, reader, writers, all the things you can also be done with monitors also. Why? Because when compared with the semaphores, monitors are more efficient. But when it comes to the monitors, like in order to have the establishment connection between them, like it is going to take somewhat of time. But we can provide synchronization by making use of monitors. So now we'll be going to discuss regarding the monitors now. So here, what is the drawback you have faced over here? So when we have considered this problem, what is the drawback you have faced? Like here, like we are going to find this race condition, right? Why? Because P1 is using B and C, at the same time P2 is using C. So that inconsistency of data will be get on C, so that we call it as a race condition. But what we have to do is we have to avoid the race condition. Today we'll be going to learn the concept of monitors, which is a very important concept in which we are going to provide synchronization. So what do you mean by a monitor? So monitor is nothing but like we can say it is a class. Monitor is nothing but a class. In normal words, a monitor is nothing but a class. So what do the class contains? Class contains the variables, fine, and class contains functions. Right? So a class monitor, I am telling you in a simple way that a monitor is nothing but a class which contains variables and functions. So what we are going to do is we are keeping those variables and functions in a module, and that module we call it as a monitor. Fine. So I'll be going to draw the diagram of the monitor. So this is our race condition. So here, when we are going to discuss the concept of monitor, here it will be. So what I have said you, a monitor is a module. So this is a module. A monitor is a module. So monitor contains what? It contains variables. I'm writing the variables over here. Here we are going to have the variable A. Here we are going to have the variable B, and here we are going to have the variable C. So these are the two variables we are having. So here A, this is B, and this is C. So variables, or else we can say that these are the shared variables. So these are the shared variables. So, and again, monitors contains functions. We can also say functions as procedures, fine. So monitors, we can say the functions also as a procedure, fine. So here we'll be going to have a procedure 1 and procedure 2 and procedure 3, fine. And here are the processes P1, P2 and P3. So this is the structure of a monitor. So what I have said you is, so what do you mean by a monitor? In the sense, a monitor is a module. So it is a module which consisting of a shared variables and procedures. So this we call it as a monitor. So here normally we have find a difficulty. We have found a race condition when we are going to make use of this variables like this. So when it comes with the monitor, so whenever a process wants to access a shared data, it can't access it directly. So that is the first point you have to notify. You have to remember. So if a process P1 wants to access the variable A, shared variable A, through this procedure only they have to access this shared variable A. So here P1 has the accessing a B variable and the C variable. So P1, by making use of procedure 1, like it is going to access the B variable for P1. So process P1 has entered into the monitor. So once when a process, this process enters into the monitor, so we'll be going to have a lock on this process P1. So this process P1 is going to be locked. So when a process is there in the monitor, the strict rule we have to follow is no other process is allowed in enter into the monitor. So that is how we'll be going to provide mutual exclusion when it comes to the monitor. Strictly that will be going to follow. So if suppose process P2 wants to enter into the monitor, it is not allowed. Why? Because already process P1 is there. So this process P2 will be added to the blocking queue. So will be added to the blocked queue. And if suppose process P3 wants to enter, for this process P3 also same condition as process P1 is there, it is not allowed to enter process P2 or process P3 to enter into the monitor. So these two will be in the blocking queue. So here there will be a queue. I'll be showing you the diagram. Here there will be a queue. So here this is the monitor. Suppose this is the monitor. So process P1 is there inside the monitor, and process P2 wants to enter into the monitor, but it is not allowed inside the monitor. Why? Because process P1 is there inside the monitor. So that's the reason what we are going to do is, so we are going to place this process P2 in the blocking queue. So this process P2 is placed in the blocking queue. And here the process P3 also wants to enter into the monitor, but already P1 has blocked the monitor. So process P3 also will be entered into the blocking queue. So this blocking queue is there. Why this queue is there? In the sense, whatever the process that are blocked, those processes are going to be entered in this blocking queue. When P1 has completed task and it has been exited, this lock has been removed. So this lock will be removed. So when the lock is removed, P1 will exit out of the room and P2 will enter into the monitor. Now it is the turn of the P2 to enter into the monitor. Now P2 is there in the monitor and P3 is always already in the blocked state. So it is going to wait in the blocked queue. So this is the basic concept of a monitor. Fine. I think you have a brief idea what is a monitor in the sense. Suppose in the previously when two process wants to execute a shared variable simultaneously, like we are going to face problem with the race condition, which is not at all to be entertained. So in order to overcome that race condition, like we have used the synchronization tools, semaphores or the monitor. Semaphores we have seen previously. So when today in this class we are going to discuss only with the monitors. Fine. So when it comes to the monitor, what I said you was a monitor is a module. Module in the sense one part. What that part contains? That part contains the shared variables and the procedures. Fine. So as I have said you here, this is a monitor, this is a module. So that module contains the shared variables and the procedures. So if any process wants to use the shared variable, they have to use or they have to communicate with the procedure only. They can't communicate directly with the shared variables, which is not at all going to be done. So they have to communicate with the procedure, and this procedure will communicate with the shared variables. So one and another important thing you have to remember is when any process is there in the monitor, how many processes are there, they have to wait in the block queue only. Only one process is allowed inside the monitor to order to execute. So mutual exclusion is going to be very much high. So we need not pay much of the attention. But when it comes to the semaphores, like what we have done, we have been used the wait and the signal. So like we are going to increment wait, decrement the wait, increment the signal. Like that we are going to do many of the wait conditions and many of the signal conditions. Like if anything is missing, like we'll be going to enter into the deadlock situation or the stress condition. So that much care is not going to be paid for this monitor. Simply, why simply in the sense, if anything is there inside, we are going to keep a lock for that. So after releasing that lock only, like we'll be going to have the data to be shared among this variables. So these shared variables, so I have said you that shared variables and the monitors. So we can apply two operations on shared variables. What are the two operations in the sense? So the first operation is here, the first operation is wait operation and the second operation is signal operation. The first operation is wait and the second operation is signal. Wait in the sense, what does it mean is, one process is already there in the monitor, you just wait. Signal in the sense, when that process has completed its task in the monitor, when it exited out, then we are going for the signal. So this is the brief introduction regarding the monitors. Now we will be going to see the theory part of this monitors. So what do you mean by a monitor? A monitor is a highly structured programming language construct. So what is like it is, and simply we can say it is a module. So which consisting of shared variables and procedures. So in simple you can say it. Oh, like there are we can apply two operations on this shared variables. The first one is wait operation and the second one is signal operation. Wait in the sense, already one process is there in the monitor, like you have to wait. Signal in the sense, the pass that process came out of the monitor so that you can enter into that monitor. So here it consists of private variables, private procedures that can only be used within a monitor. So another thing you have to remember is, whenever you are going to deal with a monitor, everything is going to be private. There will be nothing in public. So see here, note that monitors have no public data. Public data won't be there. Why? Because like when we see here, this is the monitor diagram. So when process P1 enters into that, means this P1 will be going to have the private data, this P1 will have the private procedures, P1 will have to initialize, and P1 after any queue is waiting in the sense, it has to wait in the entry queue. So that each and every data is going to be private in monitors. Like we can simply say that a monitor is a mini operating system, like a operating system with the monitor procedures as well as system calls. So when we are going to have the monitors from to be changed from one process to another process, we'll be going to make use of system calls in order to have the switching between the processes. So monitor mutual exclusion. So I have said you that monitor provides a best mutual exclusion. Why? Because if any process is there inside a monitor, like I have shown you in the previous diagrams, like, so this is the monitor. If any process is there, suppose P1 is inside the monitor in the sense, whatever the processes, P2, P3, P4, how many processes are there, they have to wait. They are not supposed to enter into this monitor. They have to wait. So the mutual exclusion is guaranteed with the monitor. So only one process it is going to allow in the sense, we don't find any of the problem. So one after another, if you are going to do in the sense, we can synchronize the things. But at a time, all the things, all the processes are doing in the sense, we'll be going to not provide synchronization. So when a process calls a monitor procedure and enters the monitor successfully. So suppose here a P1 is a process that calls the monitor procedure and entered into the monitor successfully. It is the only process executing in the monitor, that you have to remember. And when a process calls a monitor procedure and the monitor has a process running, so suppose if P2 calls a monitor procedure, but inside the monitor one process is already running, then this P2 will be blocked outside the monitor only. So that is the important thing, and that is the finest thing when we are going to deal with the monitors. So if any process is inside, in the sense, it is not at all allowed for the next process to inside into the process. So basically this monitor has four components. What are the four components in the sense? The first one is the initialization. After initialization, we'll be going to have the private data, private procedures we'll be going to have, and that is monitor procedures we'll be going to have, and finally the monitor entry queue. So this is the initialization. So whatever the thing, we have to initialize. First initialization, and that, and after that it is going to have private data, then it will be going to have private procedures, and finally you will be going to have the entry queue. So what do you mean by an initialization component? So this initialization component contains the code that is used exactly once when the monitor is created. So when like this is one monitor, this is one module. So when this module is created, you have to, when a monitor has initialized this one, so must and should, when a monitor is created, first it has to initialize this one. So that is the initialization. Private data, it contains all private data including private procedures that can only be used within the monitor only. Outside the monitors we are not at all using this data. Within the monitor only, that procedures, that private data, everything is going to be used within that monitor only. Thus these private items are not visible from outside of the monitor. So who is, whatever the processes that are waiting outside, this data, private data, is not visible to the processes that are waiting outside the monitor. And monitor procedure, as I said you, monitor procedure are the procedures that can be called outside from the monitors. As I have said you that this is the monitor, and P1, P2, P3 are the processes. They are, if they want to access the shared data, in the sense, they have to call the procedure first. They have to some get procedure and set procedure. So they have to call the get procedure. So get procedure will get the data of B item. Suppose if it wants to increment, in the sense, suppose set of 1. So it will be incremented by 1. Suppose if B value is equals to 2, when after set operation B value is equals to 3, and that data will be returned to the procedure. So after that procedure has exited out, then only process P2 will enters into the system. So that is the thing. So monitor procedures are procedures that can be called from outside of the monitor but not the inside of the monitor. And monitor entry queue contains all threads that called monitor procedure but not been granted permissions. So monitor queue, in the sense, so as I have said you here, P1 is having the chance first. So this P1 is in the monitor first. What this P2 and P3 will be doing, they'll be going to the monitor queue. So monitor queue, monitor entry queue, in that entry queue it will be waiting. Whenever the P1 came out of the monitor, this P2 will enter. So that is the thing. So this is how the private data monitor, suppose if P1 process, P2 process and P3 process are waiting, in the sense, first this P1 process has initialized this monitor. When a process P1 monitor is created, it has to initialize. So P1 is going to have the private data, and P1 is going to have the monitor, private monitor procedures. These procedures are not visible by the, for the P2 and P3 processes. Why? Because they are outside the monitor. Only the process which are inside the monitor can be going to have access all this. And P2 and P3 will be in the entry queue. So P2 will be there and P3 will be there in the entry queue. Why? Because already P1 is there in the monitor, and P2, P3 will be waiting at the entry queue. So whenever P1 completed its task, next P2 will be having the enter into the monitor. So these are the four components that are going to have for the monitor. So monitors are supposed to be used in multi-threaded or multi-process environment. As we all know, like if you are going to have a single thread, there is no need of synchronization or cooperation between the processes. When we are going to have a multiple threads or the multiple processes, we need this monitors to be synchronizing. So monitor guarantees that at any moment only one thread can be executing in the monitor. So as I've said you, only one thread will be there in the monitor at any point of view. A thread calls a monitor procedure, this thread will be blocked if there is another thread. So if one thread has called the, suppose P2 has called the monitor procedure, but P1 is already there in the monitor, then P2 will be in blocked condition. Those threads we are not granted the entering permission will be queued. So these threads will be queued in the entry queue, or this queue we'll be going to have, so that after P1 process completing, then we'll be going to give permission for the P2 process to enter into the monitor. When monitor becomes empty, so no process is there in the monitor, then one of the thread in this entry queue, so P2 and P3 are there, so one of the thread in this entry queue will be going to give a chance to enter into the monitor. So that is regarding the monitors. And we have previously seen regarding the semaphores also. Like I have, when we have deal with the producer, consumer, readers, writers, and dining philosophers problem, we have done with the semaphores, right? By making use of that semaphore variable, like how many resources are there. So we are going to take all the resources. And the, like that, we have done the thing. So now let us see what is the difference between the semaphore and a monitor. So the basic difference between a semaphore and a monitor is that semaphore is an integer variable S. It is a variable, but monitor is an abstract. It is a data type. It is an abstract data type. This semaphore is going to be represented with the S symbol. So, which indicates the number of resources available in the system. Suppose 5 resources are there in the sense, S is equals to how much? 5. So, this S is the one which is going to indicate number of resources that are going to be shared among the processes. So, that S is going to be represented with 5. So, whereas monitor is the abstract data type which allows one process to execute in the critical section at any point of time. So, that is the basic thing of a monitor. So when you see at any point of time, only one process will be there executing in the monitor. We don't have any chance of mis-synchronizing or any chance of getting two processes inside the monitor. So only one process will be inside the monitor. The value of a semaphore can be modified by wait and a signal. Wait in the sense, suppose 5, S is equals to 5. So here S is equals to 5. So this semaphore value can be modified by making use of wait and a signal. Wait of 5 in the sense, what is the answer? Wait of S in the sense, then it will be 5 will be getting into 4. And again signal of S in the sense, then again 4 will be getting to 5. So this semaphore value can be modified by making use of this wait and signal. Wait in the sense decremented by 1, signal in the sense incremented by 1. On the other hand, a monitor has a shared variable and the procedures only through which shareable variables can be accessed by the process. So here this monitor, what we are having? So is monitor having the shared variables and the procedures. So if any process want to access in the sense, they have to access through this procedure only. They can't directly access this shared variables. In a semaphore, when a process wants to access the shared resources, the process performs wait. Suppose here we are initializing that wait is equals to 1, fine. If a process wants to access in the sense, we are going to make it 0, that is we are going to lock. Then 0 indicates that already one process is using that one, you need not enter, right? So operation and block the resource, and when the release it resource, then it performs a signal. Signal in the sense, again it will be going to 1, so that 1 indicates that anyone can access this particular resource. if it is zero in the sense, nobody shouldn't access this particular resource. If one in the sense, anybody can access this particular resource. So monitor type has a condition variable which semaphore doesn't have. So monitors are going to have a condition variables. Condition variables means they, in this condition variables also you can perform two operations, that is wait and signal operation. So what do you mean by waits operation in the sense, if any process is there in the monitor, like it has to wait, where it will be going to wait? It has to wait in the blocked queue. So we are keeping a queue now, so that in that P2 process we are going to make it wait. Signal in the sense, when P1 comes out of this monitor, that P1 will enter into this monitor. This is how the difference between the semaphores and monitors are going to be done. So we'll be going to discuss the next topic, which is known as message passing model of process communication. Already we have seen in inter-process communication, right? So what are the two different types of, like, inter-process communication in the sense how the processes are going to be communicated with each other? Like we have seen that shared memory and the message passing. Here, shared memory in the sense we'll be going to share a memory between the processes. There, how it is going to be done, we have seen already. Just go and watch that video once again. And next model is the inter-process communication. Next model is the message passing. So message passing in the sense, like if you are going to have two systems, suppose here you will be going to have two systems, like this is a process one and this is a process two. So when we are going to communicate between these two systems, like we'll be going to have this message passing model. So process communication is the mechanism provided by the operating system that allow process to communicate with each other. How this process one and process two will communicate in the sense, by message passing, we are making this process P1 and process P2 to communicate with each other. This communication could involve a process letting other process know that some event has occurred of transferring the data from one process to another. So when one process transfers data to another or an event triggered, then only we can say that the communication is taking place between the process P1 and the process P2. One of the models of process communication is this message passing model. Fine. So this message passing model allows the process to read or write the data into the message queue without being connected to each other. So messages are stored in the queue until the recipients have received them, retrieves them. So here this process P1 is there and the queue is there. Here the process P2 is there. P1 sends a message, some X message is there. Until unless this process P2 has taken that message, this process, this data will reside in this message queue only. When this process P2 has taken this data, then only this process P1 will keep another data. Until unless the P2 is taken the data will reside in the message queue only. Message queue are quite useful for inter-process communication and are used by most operating systems. So messages queues are nothing but the, all the messages are going to be stored X, Y, Z. So if P1 and P2 are there, if P1 sends some XYZ message to P2, so until unless this P2 has taken this XYZ message, this XYZ message will reside in the message queue only. That is very useful. So this is the message passing model. Here there are two processes P1 and P2. This is the message queue, M1, M2, till so on, Mn. Here will be the kernel. So if process P1 sends a message to process P2, that message it will be going to keep in the message queue. So when this process P2 has taken that message, suppose here M2 is there. If process P2 has not taken the message, that message will be there in the message queue only. If this part P2 has taken by the M2 has taken by the process P2, then only it here it will be going to deleted. So this is the block diagram of the message passing model. So why this message passing is needed in inter-process communication? So actually it means, it refers to the means of communication between different threads in a process. So this is a different threads in the sense, like this is a process P1, and this process P1 is divided into three threads, T1, T2, and T3. So this is the communication between different threads within a process and different processes. So P1 and P2 are different processes running on the same node. These two are running on the same node. We can provide communication between these two processes, and we can provide communication between the different processes running on, this is node 1 and this is 2-1. So P1 running on node 1 and P2 running on node 2. In between these also we can provide messages. So in order to pass messages between different threads in a single process, or a different process working on a single node, or different process working on a different nodes. For all this, in order to communicate through messages, we need a message passing. In this, a sender or a source process sends a message to a destination. Suppose P1 is the sender and P2 is the receiver. This sender will send a message to the destination. Message has a predefined structure. Why? Because like a structure in the sense, we used to call as a send and receive. So send in the sense, name of the destination. Suppose here P1 wants to send message to P2. Here what it will be going to do is send, name of the destination is P2 and message is XYZ. Receive. Receiver, what it will be going to do, name of the source person, that is P1, and the message is some PCY. Like this, we'll be going to have the communication between the two processes, P1 and P2. It is, this message is a predefined one. Why? Because the sender knows about the destination and the destination knows about the sender. So if I want to contact with some X person in the sense, I'll be going to contact with that X person only, but not with Y and Z. In the same manner, if process P1 wants to communicate with process P2, it will be going to write that name. I want to send message to P2, comma, what the message you are sending, that message will be going to send. In the same manner, if P2 wants to communicate with P1, to whom you want to communicate P1, what is the message you want to communicate, some sort of message. So this is how it, process A and process B, send and receive. So this is the one-way communication, send, and this is how we'll be going to receive. And next, in this sender and receiver process, address each other by names. So here, this names, we call it as a naming concept. How two processes are coming in the sense, by making use of naming. So mode of communication between those two processes can be of direct communication or indirect communication, or direct addressing or indirect addressing. Direct addressing in the sense, as I have said you, A knows B and B knows A. If A wants to send a message in the sense, A to which, to whom, to B, some, what's the, some data it wants to send. And if B wants to send information in the sense to A, or what the data it want to send, it will be going to send. See, send to B. So send to B the message. Receive from A the message. So as it is a naming, we know it before. It is a structured one, we know it before. So when A and B are communicating, a link is going to be established between the A and B. In order to communicate between the A and B, a link is going to be established. Here the receiver knows the identity of A, identity of the sender, and sender knows the identity of the receiver. This we call it as an symmetric addressing. This type of arrangement we call it as an symmetric addressing. So here we are having two different types of addressing, direct addressing and the indirect addressing. Direct addressing, again we are having symmetric addressing and the asymmetric addressing. Symmetric addressing in the sense, source knows the destination name and destination knows the source name, so that they can directly send the message. So when it comes to the asymmetric one, here where receiver does not know the ID of the sending process. Here receiver, this is the receiver, this is the sender. So sender, what it will be going to send? Sender will give the destination address B only, but this B doesn't know from where it is coming. It doesn't know that the message is from A. So it has received the message and it will send back. So this is the asymmetric addressing. Symmetric addressing in the sense, here what we'll be going to have, send B comma message, here receive A comma message. This is symmetric addressing. But when it comes with asymmetric addressing, in the sense the receiver does not know where the information has come, that is of asymmetric addressing. These two comes under direct ring addressing. When it comes to the indirect addressing, so here indirect addressing, in the sense here sender will be there and here receiver will be there. These sender and receiver are going to communicate by making use of mailbox. By making use of mailbox, this sender and receiver are used to communicate. See here, in this message, send and receive from a mailbox. A mailbox used to be there. A mailbox can be abstractly viewed as an object into which messages may be placed, or from messages can be deleted. If suppose sender wants to send some message, in the sense it will be going to send some data on the mailbox, and the receiver will be going to take the data from that mailbox only. So they can't communicate directly, which is called as indirect communication. The sender and the receiver process should share a mailbox to communicate. Without this third party is the mailbox. Without this mailbox, this sender and the receiver can't communicate with each other. The following are the different types of communications through mailbox. So one-to-one link, that means one sender will be there, wants to communicate with one receiver. So then single link is established between the sender and the receiver. Next one is many to one. So here many senders will be there and one receiver will be there. So this many to one means many senders wants to communicate with one receiver. So here in the sense the example is client server communication. Many clients will be there but only one server which is going to provide services to all the clients. So many to one in the sense you can take an example of client server communication. The mailbox here we call it as a port, and one to many, here only one sender will be there and many receivers will be there. So this one sender and many receivers. So here the example is the broadcasting. The message should be broadcast to many of the people. So then one to many link is going to be there. Many to many, multiple senders will be there and multiple receivers will be there in order to communicate. So these are the different types of communication in indirect addressing. Fine. Direct addressing and the indirect addressing. In direct addressing, we'll be going to have symmetric and asymmetric. Symmetric in the sense receiver knows the destination name and destination knows the receiver's name, that is symmetric. And when it comes to the asymmetric, the receiver knows the destination name but the destination doesn't know the receiver name, that we call it as an asymmetric. And finally we'll be going to see the advantages of disadvantages of message passing model. So when another model what we are going to have, this is the shared memory model. So when it comes to the shared memory, when we compare to the shared memory, this message passing model is very much simple. But the drawback when it comes to the message passing model is that providing links between the sender and the receiver is going to be a bit difficult. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of using the message passing model. This is how the monitors and the message passing models have been covered. So when we are going to deal with the monitors, it is a module or it is a class which consisting of different shared variables and the procedures. Fine. So when we are going to keep that shared variables and procedures in a module, we call that module as a monitor. So when it comes to the semaphores, we can directly communicate. But when it comes to the monitor, if any process wants to access the shared variable, in the sense it has to get the permission to get inside the monitor, inside the monitor procedures will be there. By making use of that procedure only, it has to access the shared variable. So like this, we have concluded this semaphores, monitors, and what are the difference between the monitors and semaphores. And we have seen the different communication methods, that is inter-process communication, that is shared memory, and the last one is the message passing. With this, we'll be going to conclude the class for today. Fine, hope you all got information regarding this monitors and the message passing, and we'll be going to meet you in the next class. Thank you all students, have a bright day.